being too loud. I'm never criticized for being not loud. I'm usually yelling. Okay, so we are done with the quiz. Brittany will make, will update marks. Generally, not bad. This is actually perfect. For the third year class, 70% average is good. It is 13% less than last year, which means, and the only difference I made are those two additional questions, written questions. But that only means that I distinguished, because last year when I literally gave same quiz last year, just minus question 37 and 38, it was 83%. And then I had to go to talk to the assistant associate chair, because it's not usual to have that. And apparently my quiz was not made properly to distinguish between A plus and C minus students, which is something that I have to do. So that's why I was thinking how to change that, and I added those two written questions, and that's what we see. 10%, 13% drop. In terms of quiz two, so somebody asked on e-class, and I will respond later. I forgot who asked. Yes, I will again post practice questions from the book, like for the quiz one. Even though I know that questions 37 and 38 made a difference, let's be honest, you had those questions. I posted them with an answer key on your class. So I literally took both questions from practice questions that were on your class. And those four confirmations of endosymbiotic theory, I said that in second class that I will ask that on exam multiple times. So it was very clear. It was on slide 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, and I said that I said that I will ask that question. So and same with anamoxazoles, like multiple times checked. So there was no confusion. There was no surprise. There were many people who were writing a lot, but nothing correct. So that the thing is, and very, this is common confusion among students, and I heard that from my colleagues when I was a student. So I will just write something they don't read. Well, we have to read. We are kind of paid to read. So I have to read what you wrote, and if you wrote me 5 pages and neither of that makes sense, or it's not what I asked you, it's 0 points. That's how it goes. And unfortunately, we can't do anything about that, but the quiz two, there will be, again, like I'm posting practice questions directly from a book, and written questions come from there. So if you learn that, you will get it. Like, no way. Like, there are no hidden intentions. Like, everything is there. So again, if not sure, if you need help, Brittany and I are here. We are both very willing to help. I am busy with two more classes. That's why I'm not responding and I'm not helpful in the way I want. I just don't have a physical, I don't have time. That's the thing. Like, there are 24 hours in one day and I have to go home at one point. And sometimes I need to sleep. So I'm doing my best to help. I'm really trying. This is not easy, but both of us are really here to help. So please don't hesitate to seek for help. Brittany is really great TA and she knows a lot, so she can help, and she can help you study. I know she knows how to study. She's the best, absolutely best in that. So ask her for tips and tricks. She knows it. Anyway, let's move on with the diversity of bacteria. CPBs will be, it's a very short lecture, so I'm not very worried for being late because we will anyway finish earlier. These lectures are purposefully very short because, in my opinion, this is like second quiz will be the hardest. Because I personally hate memorization, and there will be, like, if people are not used to bacterial names, there might be confusion. But again, I'm giving you hints, and If I say oscillatory alimnetica, acidotiobacillus ferrooxidans, that's what I'm going to ask. So I literally tell you what I'm going to ask. You just have to make a note and listen. Like, I'm even recording my sessions if you didn't make a note. So, TPV, chlamydia, plancomycetes, and verrucomicrobia. And I'm pretty sure that about chlamydia you already heard, unfortunately. So we all heard about it. Yeah, so it's a common problem, but let's see how we can talk about that from scientific side. So all these plancomycetes, verrucomicrobia, chlamydia, they all share common ancestor, which means they're closely related based on 16S rRNA. And again, the purpose of me showing you this phylogenetic tree is just to show you that the reason why we are talking about these three phyla is because they all share common ancestors. So if you analyze their 16S rRNA, it will pretty much be the same. So they're very similar. They're phylogenetically related. And again, this field for CPV, I named it CPV. There is no official name CPV. The reason why I call them CPV and fat bacteria, Firmicutes actinomycetes, and Enterocutes, I call fat bacteria, is because I am trying to help students to memorize somehow easily, because it's not so easy to memorize those ridiculous Latin names. So, chlamydia or CPV? So, part of CPV, chlamydia, C stands for C. So, there is only one order, chlamydiales. What that means, that so chlamydia are those bacteria often known as so they're intracellular, obligate intracellular parasites, which makes them very similar to virus, but they are not virus. So they have to live, they require intracellular environment to live, but they are not viruses, they are bacteria, but they have some specific characteristics. They're human pathogens. What that means is that when something is pathogenic, that has reduced genome. Why reduced genome? Because it relies, so if something is parasitic, it relies on host genome. So, for example, chlamydia lives in our organism and it usually lives intracellularly. So, it uses our cellular machinery, so it doesn't have to develop so many genes. Unlike, for example, soil bacteria that have huge genomes because they have to develop multiple genes to survive complex environments. So, chlamydia are biochemically limited. Again, parasites, they have very specific requirements. There, so in terms of chlamydia life cycle, there are two types of cells, reticular and elementary body. So, elementary body, which you can conclude by name, is only there for transmission. So it's very dense and dry resistant. So it's only there, it only helps in transmission, like a typical parasitic life form. A reticulate body, so a reticule means network. It's less dense, it's non-infectious, and it's there for multiple, for binary fusion. So again, it can be confusing why it's not infections. Well, it's already there. So it's only there to multiply. What are those species of chlamydia? Chlamydia trachomatis. And there is chlamydia that can cause, there is another chlamydia that can cause genital infection. Some genes that are present in the chlamydia are eukaryotic origin, so that indicates the existence of horizontal gene transfer, or AGT. Remember, AGT was very intensive, like part long, long time ago. But then, as barrier increased between life forms, AGT stopped. But it's still not stopped. It decreased. It was reduced, but it's still happening. And chlamydia is one of the examples because those genes that were transferred might facilitate pathogenic lifestyle. So that's evolution, result of evolution. Again, the way how you will always recognize chlamydia is because it's very specific. It has two life forms, typical parasitic lifestyle, cannot live without the cell. And That's why if you ever had chlamydia test, your OB has, I mean, for females, usually it's for females, has to scratch your skin because it tries to get living cell to isolate chlamydia because it won't get isolated if it's out of cell. One of the key adaptations of chlamydia is the gene for protein FTSZ. What is FTSZ? So people who just had midterm in 311 know that that's a main divisor protein. Chlamydia doesn't have it, so that's one of housekeeping genes in all bacteria, but chlamydia doesn't have it, and there is no peptidoglycan. So genes are present, but it's not expressed. So that's weird. But why would they? They live parasitic lifestyles, so they don't really technically need it. So that's called the chlamydia anomaly. Basically, what that means is bacteria. So again, this is just repetition for people who didn't take 265 or 311. So bacterial cell wall is built of peptidoglycan. Peptidoglycan contains those monomers Neg and Nem, and one of the characteristics of bacterial peptidoglycan Neg and Nem monomers is the ala motif, which is peptide, like peptides, three conservative and two three variable and two conservatives, which is the ala, which is penicillin analog. So the ala is a trigger for penicillin, like that's how penicillin and vancomycin. Well, vancomycin is recognizing different targets, but penicillin targets the ala, which means in chlamydia there is no in chlamydia there is no those poly there are no those polymers in the cell wall. There are no Neg and Nems, so that means that we would say there is no transpep there is no target for penicillin, but penicillin can still be used to treat chlamydia, and that phenomenon is known as chlamydia anomaly. Why is that happening? I don't exactly know, but doctor will actually give you penicillin to treat chlamydia, and it's weird because technically there is no target for penicillin. Again, penicillin targets the ala motif, which is in peptidoglycan. Chlamydia does not have peptidoglycan. It does have genes, but it doesn't express them. But still, penicillin targets them. So the proposal, and again, this is just proposal, and I found the paper last year. I'm not sure if that got changed. That in chlamydia, there is a use of glycan-less wall polymer, some specific polymer, whose synthesis is penicillin sensitive. So it's like a analog to the ala, something different than the ala, but still penicillin targets it. Just a proposal. I'm not sure what I'm not sure if there is a new research on that topic. But what I wanted to know is chlamydia anomaly, that chlamydia does not have peptidoglycan, but it does have genes for peptidoglycan, and penicillin antibiotic that targets component of cell wall called the ala targets can affect chlamydia as well, but it's unclear how, because technically it's not expressed, and that's why we call that chlamydia anomaly. And one of the proposals is glycanless cell wall, so something different than the ala that is also affected by penicillin. Another phyla, so P in CPV phyla, is Planctomycetes, and we already mentioned a few of them. I think we did. So, what is common for Planctomycetes? These organisms have, and this is their characteristic, which I want you to get from this. So, from Planctomycetes, they have intracellular compartments that often resemble cellular organs. So, extensive cellular compartmentalization is characteristic of Planctomyces. And if you think about differences between eukaryotic and prokaryotic cells, One of the key differences is that our cell, our eukaryotic cell, actually has compartments. We have organelles, we have ER, we have Golgi apparatus, we have nucleus. Bacterium or microbes, well, bacteria, like prokaryotes, they don't have it. But this group, see, like Planktomycetes, they shows like extensive compartmentalization that I personally don't like calling organelles, but some of them really resemble true cell organelles. And these are famous and Brocardia. Where did we hear about Brocardia? Brocardia anammoxidans. We talked about anammoxosomes. That was a question in quiz one. So again, Planktomyces is usually key order because Planktomycetes and you have Planktomyces. But let's talk about gemmata first. So again, extensive cellular compartmentalization. So pyrrolozomes or pyrrolelozomes. Again, I will never ask you to spell this. There is like if I give you the question, it will be to recognize it. So and this is the sign of that compartmentalization, which I want you to memorize here. So pyrrolelozomes contain that nucleoid and membrane enclosed. So it's like a membrane enclosed structure, like nucleoid, which is a DNA covalently closed circular super coiled, but it's also highly condensed in these pyrrolelozomes. And there are ribosomes also in that like structure, like DNA. So you will have nucleoid form of DNA, like covalently closed circular. That's prokaryotic characteristic. But the level of condensation in those pyrrolelozomes is so huge that really resembles eukaryotic nucleus. And you have ribosomes around it. So that's that compartmentalization that resembles eukaryotic structure. So this is just example of what's happening in gemmata. So pyrrolelozomes are present in gemmata. Like we talked about like carboxysomes, anammoxosomes, magnetosomes. Pyrrolelozomes are like a transcription translation apparatus condensed and replication. Again, if you think about level of condensation in eukaryotic cell, does anyone know how big would be DNA if you unwind it from our cell? It would wrap a few times around the planet. But how you put it in a nucleus? Condensation, because you have like DNA structure, ATGC, which I tattooed, and then you have nucleosome, like when DNA wraps, forms nucleosomes, and then you have multiple levels of packing. That's how we get all that DNA. Bacteria don't have that, but these guys are resembling that both packing and condensation. Planktomyces, because they're Planktomyces is their gemmata. That's why it's red, not because it's more important than another. What is Planktomyces? It's a budding bacteria. What means budding bacteria? That means it has two poles on the cell and it has Schwarber cell with flagellum and it's talc bacteria. So the way how it functions is the talc has cell wall and it's filled with cytoplasm. Where did we hear about talc again? We talked about the talc. When we talk about Calmobacterium crescentis, which is alpha proteobacteria. So they're very similar, but not the same. And the difference, so this is non-testable, this is just like all this writing is non-testable, it's from paper. Why I'm giving you this slide is because very often people get confused when we mention stalk. And the polar organization people associated with Calmobacter crescentis. Calmobacter crescentis does have stalk, but it's alpha proteobacteria and it's not the same like as the one that exists in Planktomycetes. So we will talk more about Calmobacter. So maybe we already talked, I just forgot. But what happens in this alpha proteobacteria in Calmobacter? So it's again, this is not Planktomycetes. There are morphological changes during cell division. So they will have like a swarmer cell with flagellum and pili at one pole for movement and for dispersal, but it doesn't do DNA replication. And swarmer cell, the one with flagellum, and stalk is growing as extension from cell envelope, which again, this is not quantum mitosis. I'm just telling you that that asymmetric cell division in Campylobacter gives rise to the two different cell types. It says those two cell types have different fates, and the way how that occurs in the that asymmetric cell division is something that occurs through tight regulation of polarly organized proteins in Campylobacter crescentis. But that's not in quantum mimesis. Quantum mimesis does not have asymmetric cell division. So that the reason why I'm giving you that is because it can happen that confusion occurs between Campylobacter and plankton mimesis. So plankton mimesis has stalk that is filled up with cell wall and cytoplasm. When it divides equally. It's symmetric. There is no polar organization. It will always be with stalk. Campylobacter, on the other hand, like alpha proteobacteria, has very complex polar organization and tightly controlled cellular signaling, where you will have one stalked cell and swarmer cell, so completely asymmetric cell division. And that can be used, that asymmetric cell division has been exploited in biotechnology, but that's completely different topics. I'm not going to go there. And now our favorite, Brocardia anammoxidans. So this is something that I keep asking, and this is something that will come up. Anammoxosomes, Brocardia anammoxidans, main structures that really keep this organism important. So this is anammox bacteria that does anaerobic oxidation of ammonia, and it's respiring nitrite. The key in these organisms is that while they are using electron donor ammonium and respiring nitrite, they produce toxic hydrazine and many other things. But the key is hydrazine, N2H2. N2H2 hydrazine is very toxic, which is the reason why these organisms have to develop that extensive intracellular compartment, which means all that process is happening in the anammoxosomes, which are surrounded by ladder and lipids. Ladder and lipids are the key words here. And they have to have them because that's how it protects from leaking of hydrazine. And that's something that I will ask constantly because I think it's important to learn. Verrucomicrobia, you already heard about this. It's we mentioned it. Most of these organisms we mentioned. Again, it has prosteca. So we will talk about what are prosteca. So prosteca are all those cellular extrusion, like everything extracellular are prostecas. Like so, notice that. Even this one is similar to Campylobacter, but again, quite different because there is no asymmetric cell division. So, N-plankton mimesis and verrucomicrobia will both have some like extrusions, like prosteca, like stalk would be called prosteca. But it's not the same type of stalk like in Campylobacter because in this case, plankton mimesis, verrucomicrobia, both cells are the same. It's symmetric. In Campylobacter, it's asymmetric. So, that's the difference. And it's famous by symbiotic association with protists. Protists are microanimals. Like they're still animals, but they are microscopic. Which are famous genera? So Prostecobacter. How will you know it's Prostecobacter? Prosteca. That's what they're, that's what characterizing them. So they have homology with tubulin molecules eukaryotic cell. So in bacterial cell, tubulin molecule homolog is FTS. But Prostacobacter has another one that shares homology with tubulin. So that's why it's unique. The role was unknown in 2017. It might got changed. They still have FTSE, but they have another tubulin homolog. So again, that's just one of the interesting, but what Prostacobacter and its specific tubulin homolog is a key point from this slide. Hyperthermophilic organisms is what we're going to talk about now. So, where are hyperthermophilic? So, this is all from CPV. There is nothing else. We are moving to the next phyla, which will be hyperthermophilic organisms. So, what means hyperthermophilic? It means it's living on high temperature, hyper. And in this phylogenetic tree, you can see Thermotoga and Aquifex. We talked about them when we talked about specific organisms in metabolic diversity. So they're on the bottom of phylogenetic tree. So the reason why I'm showing you this phylogenetic tree is just to show you how close they are to the bottom, which means they're very old. How, and even without seeing phylogenetic tree, we can conclude that they're evolutionary old. Simply because remember when we talked about how Earth was inhospitable environment in beginning, it was very hot, like a lot of volcanoes. So these guys could live that. So Thermotoga aquifex are very down and generally characteristic of all organisms that live in high temperature in like hyperthermophilic is above 80 degrees. Some of them even can live at 120. So they're very evolutionary. And the way how you can recognize them, with exception of Aquifex, is hypothermic or hyperthermic. And when you see the name Thermodesulfobacterium, what can that tell you? Even if you don't see it. What is using to respire? Sulfur, something sulfur, desulfur, probably sulfate or sulfur, elemental sulfur. And that's how you will know that it was evolutionary old, because what was present in ancient Earth? Iron, sulfur. So Thermodesulfobacterium must be respiring somehow sulfate, sulfur, and has to have some iron component. And Thermotoga is very famous by using iron as an electron acceptor and using hydrogen as a donor. That's how you will know it was old, because what was present? Hydrogen, iron. Think about that. Iron was there all the time. When it, like iron in two forms, but in order to be respired, it has to be in three plus four. It has very high degree homology with thermophilic archaea, and we will talk about thermophilic archaea when we talk about diversity of archaea later in this class after I come back. Like Thermotoga really shares a lot of with archaea, and most commonly in high temperatures you will find archaea, but there are also hyperthermophilic bacteria. Aquifex and is very famous. We talked about it again. Hydrogen. So think about this. Thermotoga, Aquifex, they both use hydrogen as electron donor. Simple, because it was available. Sulfur and iron as electron acceptor. The sulfur will be in Aquifex, while Thermotoga will use iron. But you see that this one can also use oxygen and nitrate. What does that tell you? It's probably evolutionary younger. It evolved better because it developed ability to survive oxygen if present. But neither of them can use organic. Thermodesulfobacteria. We, as I said, what is electron acceptor? Sulfate. Probably can be sulfur as well. I don't know, but I wouldn't consider it a mistake, because usually sulfur, sulfate can both be electron acceptors depending on who is the donor. What distinguishes Thermodesulfobacterium from the Aquifex and Thermotoga is it that it can use organics? What does that tell you? It's probably evolutionary younger. Like, if something evolved to use organics, that's evolutionary younger. Those ancient ones used hydrogen. Some characteristics of thermodesulfur bacterium is that it has ethylene lipids, so that's a chiral compound. So lipid profile is kind of in between bacteria and archaea, so you can't really make a clear distinguishment. In fact, you can see that at the beginning we mentioned in the first slide, we said that these hyperthermophilic organisms really share homology with archaea, mainly in high-temperature archaea. But there are bacteria that evolve, just they share homology with archaea. And we have some, I call them lonely organisms. And Brittany will probably love this one, right? Yes, that Deinococcus radiodurans. What does the name tell you? Isn't it easy? If it's radiodurans, it's tolerant to radiation. Yeah. So you go to Chernobyl to buy a prospect from this one if you want. I mean, and then you probably die of radiation, but who cares? You extracted new Deinococcus. That's it. You fulfill your purpose in this life. Anyway, don't do that. So, Deinococcus radiodurans is the most radiation-resistant organisms, and I call them lonely. This is my, like, that's how I call them. They are placed in different phyla, but I cherry-picked specific organisms that I wanted you to, that I wanted to cover in bacterial, in bacterial class, because. Which means is that 5,000 grays, humans can survive 5, E. coli 800. This one can do 5,000. So this one has something we don't have. Of course, it does. What is the mechanism of resistance? Very active DNA repair system. Because what radiation does is damaging your DNA. This one has very active repair system, which means the moment radiation this, like damages it, this one is fixing it. There are multiple enzymes involved. The other one that you probably heard about is Thermus aquaticus. Somebody heard about TAC polymerase? That's where this, so that's where the enzyme is isolated from. It's a heat-resistant TAC polymerase. Nowadays, they made a recombinant TAC polymerase, you will find. Q5, high fidelity, DreamTAC, NEB makes their own, but they're all TAC polymerases. What they do, like, and who heard about polymerase chain reaction? PCR. So if you know that PCR goes at denaturation at 95, then you reduce temperature to the primer binding annealing, and then you increase it to 72, right? Some enzymes now work at 68, surprisingly, recombinant stuff. Why at 72? Because that's the optimum for TAC polymerase. So depending on how they modify that enzyme, NEB, for example, now has an enzyme that works optimally at 68 degrees. It's recombinant, so I have no idea what they did, but it works at 68. You increase it to 72, they'll die. Nothing, like your PCR doesn't work. I tried, and I killed it. Again, that's, it survives at high temperature. Of course, it survives. You increase the thermal cycling at 98 degrees to denature DNA. So your enzyme has to be resistant. So many, many heat-stable enzymes are isolated and modified. I have a few more slides, which is just a summary from this unit 4, which are diversity of bacteria. We will talk about diversity of archaea and eukaryotic microorganisms. And I'm trying, believe me, I'm trying to reduce as much as I can and just to give you the most funny phyla, the most funny species. That's why I have this Deinococcus radiodurans there. So, and many of these, like all, like the reason why I'm giving you a summary is because that those are key points that I want you to get from this unit. That doesn't mean you should ignore everything else, but this will be key points. And for written questions, there will be Posidonia class, and I will give two questions from this Posidonia question. Literally, same like I did for quiz one. So, alpha, so we talked about proteobacteria as a first phylum. There are six classes. Alpha proteobacteria are second largest class. Which one is the largest? Gamma. But okay, those things is something that you have to know. Like which one is the largest? Gamma, second largest alpha. Proteobacteria are generally metabolically diverse. Family genera in alpha proteobacteria are Rickettsia, Rhizobium, and Caulobacter. And you will memorize Caulobacter because we talked about this a lot and today. Beta proteobacteria, I am always insisting on Nitrosomonas. No, because Nitrosomonas is very important for nitrogen cycling and for the agriculture. Burkholderia and Neisseria. Neisseria meningitis and gonorrhea are very famous, so this might come into the game. Burkholderia, not so much, but I am really like these common names I do want you to know. Gamma proteobacteria are the largest class, and that is what I am insisting to know. Doesn't have to know, you don't have to know how many species are there, but you have to know that gamma proteobacteria are the largest one. And you will memorize that because Enterobacteria, which is E. coli, belongs to gamma proteobacteria. I'm just giving E. coli as an example. There are some other key genera in gamma proteobacteria that I will insist, like Pseudomonas vibrio. Pseudomonas is interesting because there are some species like aeruginosa that is pathogenic, and there is another one like fluorescens that is actually beneficial. The easier one is delta and epsilon proteobacteria. Delta proteobacteria are those socially active. I call them Facebook bacteria, Myxobacteria. And the so Vibrio and Geobacter is cool because it's used in microbial cell fuel cell MFC. Epsilon proteobacteria will be Helicobacter and Campylobacter. One of the things that I like to ask is Helicobacter because Helicobacter is a neutrophil that gets adapted onto our. It tricks our gut. It actually gets adapted on low pH in our gut through expression of urease. We talked about phyla-lab, lactic acid, phyla fat, when we talk about lactic acid bacteria lab, Streptococcus and Lactobacillus. Do not confuse Streptococcus and Streptomyces. Streptococcus is lactic acid bacteria used in fermentation. We mentioned also that lab bacteria, lactic acid bacteria, Streptococcus are Firmicutes. That's a F in phyla fat. We talked about that. Again, another F in phyla. So we talked about fat phyla, Firmicutes, Actinobacteria, Tenericutes, and among Firmicutes, we talked about lactic acid bacteria, sporulating and non-sporulating. Bacteria, so lactic acid bacteria or lab are Streptococcus and Lactobacillus, yogurt make creation. Sporulation is also characteristic of sporulating Firmicutes. Important is to know it's Clostridium and Bacillus. That even though endospores are usually characteristic of fungi, these bacteria also do sporulation. Tenericutes, no cell wall. It's mycoplasma. They have that's the mycoplasma. And you will see that these Tenericutes, even though they belong to different phylogenetically, mycoplasmas are very similar to chlamydia in terms of morphological structure. Just chlamydia is even more parasitic. And if you ever did chlamydia test, they probably tested you for chlamydia from mycoplasma and for ureaplasma because they are all. Characteristic by their parasitic life. The mycoplasma. Actinobacteria, which is A in fat, so Firmicutes F, A actinobacteria. Very important bacteria that I call PEB. It's called propionic acid bacterium. Why it's famous? Because it's used in fermentation of lactic acid to propionate. Which is responsible for a very characteristic flavor of Swiss cheese. Another actinobacteria that we love is Mycobacterium tuberculosis. And Streptomycetes. Again, don't get confused. Not Streptococcus. Streptococcus belongs to like lab Firmicutes. This is actinobacteria. And Streptomycetes is famous by production of antibiotic. Yard story, healing a soil from graveyard, that was Streptomycetes. Fantastic source of new antibiotics. Bacteroides, obligate anaerobes in toxic environment fermentation, specific in gastrointestinal tract of animals. We talked about microbiome and fiber, low fiber versus high fiber diet. So if you have low fiber, bacteroides will overreach Firmicutes that will affect G protein signaling, which you get to ulcerative colitis, cancer, eventually you die. So eat fibers, don't be like me. Chlamydia we talked about today. Oh, sorry, my bad. Small obligate intracellular, smaller than mycoplasmas. This one is way more resembling viruses. Planktomycetes, stalk and budding bacteria, but different type than Caulobacter. Caulobacter has asymmetric cell division. Planktomycetes is symmetric. Verrucomicrobia, famous by Prostecas, also symmetric cell division. And those hyperthermophiles, Thermotoga, Thermodesulfobacterium, and Aquifex. Important things for Aquifex, Thermotoga, and Thermodesulfobacterium: extensive horizontal gene transfer with archaea. I emphasize Aquifex because that's what I will ask. So Aquifex is using H2 as a donor, electron donor, and that's why I'm emphasizing it. And the Deinococcus and Thermus are those that I called lonely. I do want you to know that Deinococcus is the most radio-resistant organism. Doesn't matter how much it can take. I don't care about numbers, but know that it's really high. And the reason why it's high is because it has very extensive DNA repair mechanism. And that would be in this unit. Actually, I think we have one more lecture next class, but it's from the only from the paper. I mean, it will be testable. But it's a new research about how like a hydrogen evolved hydrogen utilization, and I will talk about that next slide. Okay.